As CEO of Asia Pacific and Africa at Zee Enterprises, you have been involved in making strategic decisions across 70 plus countries. What are the key points to keep in mind when implementing such strategies across varied geographies?
So in terms of what I have learned through my experience in managing the business, I would say that first of all, we have to keep our mind very, very open. As we call it, blue sky thinking. So one should never limit the thought process when we join any business or we get involved in any of the organization. There would be a lot of inputs that come from everywhere. It's okay to hear everyone out, but never limit your thought process as to what you hear from predecessors, colleagues, or people who are actually going to be telling you about the future or the past or the history of business. Once we have heard, it's always good to make our own assessment of what our feel or our plan is about the potential and how far do we see that this business can grow. It's also good to simplify what appears to be a complex situation when you hear from different people. Having people who have positive energies around you is always good, and there would be always some disconnect at some level, but then disconnect doesn't mean that everyone is supposed to think like you. It's always good to have diversity in the team. If I talk about how did I dealt with Africa or Asia Pacific. Africa is a vast continent, 50 countries, 50 plus countries, in fact. My experience having dealt with Africa in telecom business as well as in media and entertainment is that it's not really a wide brush continent. It's a fine brush continent. Every country has its own peculiarity, has its own energy, and also how do we look at our business, or that how do we segment our customer segment or the market in media, whether we are actually targeting and chasing the expat Indians or we are chasing the South Asians who actually have more or less understanding of our kind of language and the content, or we are targeting the local mainstream viewers, Africans in case of Africa and Indonesians in case of Indonesia. So, that kind of knowing the market exercise has to be done very well.
You have headed the launch of various channels under Zee International, such as Zee World and Zee Magic. What are the most important market and consumer insights to consider while launching a new channel?
First of all, important thing for any business, it's not, I would try to answer this question not only from the channel perspective, but from a typical business perspective. It could be applicable to telecom, it is applicable to the infrastructure business. First of all is know your market, know your customer. How is that possible? It is possible as to how well have you researched the market and the segment and the product that you are dealing with. In our telecom and media and broadcast business, it is actually something called focus group studies, or the typical research studies as to what's the kind of uptake of your product or the content or in what language. That's one. Knowing and well research, that's just one point. Second is customization and adaptation is very, very important for any market. I have dealt with 70 countries in last 7 years, and of course, in my 25 years of career, I have dealt across all the continents. It's, whether it is Middle East or Europe or America or Asia Pacific or Africa. These basics actually are applicable across, and this is something which was very well taught during my studies at IFT, as to how important it is to understand the customers, understand the market, how important it is to research. Customization and adaptation is very, very important because there is a regulatory environment which varies from country to country. Not necessarily that the regulator is same across the entire continent. The size of the market actually depends again you how far you want to expand the pie of your customer base. Again, whether in Asia Pacific, 19 odd countries, whether we are chasing the expat Indians or we are chasing the South Asians, which includes Bangladeshis and Sri Lankans and Pakistanis who understand different languages, like Bangladeshis understand our Bangla content and the channels very well, and Sri Lankans understand our Tamil segment very well, and Pakistan, of course, understand our Punjabi and Hindi segment very well, and of course, there are subtitles that we add. Or we are actually, chasing the local consumers by customization and adaptation in Bahasa language for Indonesian market, let's say, or in Thai language for the Thai market. So these are, few of the wider, I would say, categorization. And of course, depending on the product or the services we are dealing with, one can actually, specify and zero down on very, very, need specifics.
You have played a major and a crucial role in the joint venture among Vodafone, Bharti and Idea. So how was this experience and what went behind managing such a huge joint venture?
All right, so this one is actually, related to my stint and tenure with Indus Towers Limited, wherein I was there for about 5 years. And while, telecom business is something, it has evolved, it has grown from, it has seen different, growth patterns during different times. And I must say, during my time, it was really seeing exponential growth times because very new 3G licenses were issued to a lot of new operators, and suddenly the market was moving from half a dozen to about a dozen of operators. And this novel concept of a joint venture among three competing players, because Airtel, Vodafone and Idea were really competing with each other. So a collaboration and a joint venture among three competing partners, that was actually, something very, very innovative of the time. And the business model that one was getting into, these three players actually got into building world's largest telecom tower infrastructure company. And I was one of the fortunate ones who actually joined this JV as the vice president sales and marketing. I was the first non-JV partner employee because there was a belief that this role of sales and marketing can influence the competitive structure of a shareholder if this position starts favoring anyone. So what I actually, take pride in saying that, I won the confidence of the three shareholders that they approved me to handle this huge portfolio. And so I have very good memories of managing this because Indus Towers became a very successful Harvard Business case study. That's a bit I would say about Indus.
How would you describe your career transition from the entertainment industry based in Asia, Pacific and Africa to the health and wellness industry under the ZSL Group in the US?
So I am right now under the transition from Singapore to New York. I'm getting into a very interesting business, which is health and wellness vertical of SL Group, wherein we deal with one is the health resorts. We are having a very successful and interesting venture known as Yovan, like Y-O and numeric one. Yovan in Sanskrit means eternal youth. So in this health and wellness resort, we are dealing with the health conditions and, you know, what an interesting timing for this move. We have actually been suddenly extra conscious and concerned about the health and wellness due to COVID situations. And so we do deal with various health conditions at our wellness resort, including immunity boosting plans and so on. And this is, you know, health and wellness resort is one of the five legged ecosystem that we have in our American business. We of course do have the health and wellness lifestyle channels, television channels. So far I've been, I had managed the entertainment channels, and now, you know, I'm actually involved in the health and wellness lifestyle content and channel, which is very much American, and content has been produced outside India. And then we also are dealing with the e-commerce. We have an e-commerce business wherein we are selling herbs, naturals, and the food supplements on a dozen plus e-commerce sites, and so on. So I would say it's, you know, America's dream is, you know, everyone's dream. And I consider myself, you know, one of those few lucky ones that, you know, I got a chance to move from India to South Africa to Singapore to eventually US. And timing has been good. I'm moving when there's a dynamic and very effective health programs which the government is focused on. And also from the perspective that, you know, suddenly COVID has opened up a lot of opportunities within this segment.
What impact has the time you spent at IFT had on you, both in your personal and professional sense? And what advice would you be giving to the current batches to make the best out of the MBA?
Very interesting. I won't, so you have taken, you are now taking me back to my student days and IFT campus. What a lovely campus and the time we had. So I joined IFT as a, you know, as a graduate engineer with a couple of years of experience from the industry. Largely my experience was the Indian experience, and I tested and tasted little bit of international business also when I joined IFT for doing my exact master's in international trade. So first thing which I learned from there was certain way that we used to look at business in the Indian market. And suddenly the canvas became very wide and vast, wherein it opened up the international business. And timing was also very right, because, you know, from 1992 onward, Indian economy was opening up from being a very India-centric to suddenly, you know, we were looking at globe. And by that time, India had already made an impact within the international community by establishing ourselves from you know, whatever our traditional image was to our soft power. And then, you know, this local, global, glocal, various terminologies came in. And till during, you know, my time of 1999, we used to have a large dependence on the hardwares also. It was not only services wherein we were making impact. We were actually, you know, also ourselves focused on the product side. So the learning and what was taught in a short time by the experts at IFT had impacted my life in long term. And when I actually came out with a post graduation from IFT, I felt at least myself that, you know, I was transformed.
What is your favorite memory of IIFT?
I would say the international marketing lectures on education side and having that cup of tea outside at the tea stalls, which is the second which we do every year, even now.
We are also looking forward to that, sir. The next question would be, could you please name three people that you're still in contact with?
I'm in touch with the 200 plus alumni in Singapore. It's a very dynamic Singapore alumni chapter. And of course, my batch of 1999, that is again very active. And of course, technology made it possible that we are all connected because of the WhatsApp group and Telegram groups that we are having now.
Okay, it's brilliant to hear, sir. A book that inspired you?
I am right now having a virtual background on my back. Otherwise, you could actually, you know, see, write the books which are actually, you know, my favorite. And of course, you know, I'm quite inspired by the book of our ZSL group chairman, Dr. Subhash Chandra, the Z Factor.
Okay. The favorite country you have visited and why do you feel it's your favorite?
Okay, so it's actually a very elaborate answer because it depends that, you know, whether I'm evaluating a country from the perspective of business or from tourism or for traveling with family. So depending on, you know, when for, I would say, travel and tourism, of course, you know, in the early part of my life, I liked Paris very much and I still remember its Paris Center's map by heart. For business, in my early part of IFT, post-IFT, I had a successful business in Scandinavia, in Finland. So, you know, that was one market wherein with whatever product I was dealing at that time, I had almost 90% market share. In terms of having time with family, I think Singapore, where I am right now, it's a good place. Very good and well planned according to the family environment. And overall, if I have to rate, you know, my own as to what gives me the satisfaction the most, that whatever I set on myself, I could achieve it, it's South Africa, wherein I had 5 years. And I think overall, from 360 degrees, I'm very happy with whatever I had achieved and done and could deliver within the Africa tenure.
The next question is that an important lesson that the pandemic has taught you?
It's not one thing that we learned in pandemic time. Multiple things. One is, of course, you know, personally, because Singapore borders are closed right from March last week until now. It's first time since, you know, my memory goes back after graduation that I spent 1 year at a stretch within a country without any travel. And I got to know my own family better than what I knew before pandemic.
What is your favorite snack from Delhi?
Delhi 6, actually, you know, now you are, now it's actually, you know, getting my lunch time also, and I don't want to name one snack, but I think Delhi's chaat pakodi is something which is always missed and at the same time relished almost every evening now that we are working from home.
What is something that they don't teach you in college and you should have probably known?
I would say actually, life lessons are best learned with the failures, with the struggle when we do something and we fail to achieve that thing. So I have not learned so much from the successes as much as, I have learned with whatever, failures one had ever in life. And so it's always good to actually, go through this reflecting back times as to, what worked for me and what did not work for me and what was achieved and what is still pending to be done.
Three words that you would use to describe yourself?
I would say one is, of course, trust, which is very important. Second is patience. And third is positive attitude.
Okay, the last question. What is your success mantra and what would you advise the outgoing batch of 2022?
I would say actually, have positive people around you. So who actually, always inspire and keep motivating and have a self-belief.